Forget everything you think you know. None of that matters. You're not students anymore.
We'll take everything from them.
You're X-Men.
I don't know that when we started First Class, to be totally honest, we imagined it was going to be part of a trilogy. I was excited about really exploring the origins of specifically Eric and Charles. And then there's obviously secondary characters like Hank and Raven, who are fascinating characters. But initially for me, it was the young Charles and Eric story. And then, frankly, the actors were just so extraordinary, and the characters became even more interesting, that we continued with them into Days of Future Past. The story of these three films for me is the story of these two men, and in many ways, the woman in between the two of them, who's the sister, daughter to Charles and Raven, and the sort of lover partner to Eric.
You ready for this?
Let's find out.
When they rang up and said, are you interested in doing First Class? I thought it was a joke. I thought my agents were sort of just winding me up. And then I met with Emma Watts at Fox, and she said that we're serious. We saw Kick-Ass and were blown away by it, and we feel X-Men needs to be reinvented. It was unfinished business, because I came so close to directing X3. I mean, I literally storyboarded the whole film, and ironically, I pulled out of it because I didn't think there was enough time to make the movie. And we had so much more time on that than we did on this film.
There was a script that was based on a brilliant original idea by Bryan Singer that was there, that was the one that Matthew had seen and had a look at. And I think he immediately had in his head tons of ideas about where he wanted to take the story whilst keeping that brilliant central concept of it being set in the 60s and with the political backdrop of the time and focusing on the relationship between Professor X and Magneto.
And the catalyst between them was, for me, was Raven, Mystique, you know. So for me, it was the threesome of that, really.
In terms of the decisions that she has to make, she's the one we can relate to as she's presented with these two diverging views of the future of, you know, what it means to be different in that society.
If you're using half your concentration to look normal, then you're only half paying attention to whatever else you're doing. Just pointing out something that could save your life. You want society to accept you, but you can't even accept yourself.
Ironically, I know everyone goes on about Wolverine and all these characters they love, but I always found McKellen and Patrick Stewart really interesting when they went head-to-head in the other movies. And so I was glad that Bryan Singer had the idea of making the prequel about those two.
When I read the first 40 pages of the script after I was offered the part, that was all that existed. They hadn't written the rest yet. I saw a little bit of a hook where the character seemed like he was going in a different direction from the old Professor Charles Xavier that we've seen before. You know, he was in a pub, he was having a drink, and he was chatting someone up. And that was it, really. I thought maybe we should take that and run with that, and Matthew and Jane were both very much in agreement.
What Matthew was very clear about, and Jane from the beginning, is that you know, it was a character piece, and it was a study of characters and their relationships between one another, and the sort of set action pieces would come to sort of complement that rather than the opposite way around.
We had a lot of input, and then, you know, I think that's why they brought, they were really sort of careful in picking their actors, and I think they wanted people who could bring a discussion to the table and possibly help devise and create. And that was, you know, partly why we were excited.
Poor James, I think I drove him nuts because I made him read with all these, you know, and he wasn't used to coming in and reading. I was using him literally like a out-of-work actor, and I explained to him, I said, look, if we're doing Butch Cassidy and the Sundance Kid type of relationship here, I have to see it now. You know, I tested them together, and it took me 3 seconds. As soon as they did the first scene, I knew I'd found my Magneto and X.
Listen to me very carefully, my friend. Killing will not bring you peace.
Peace was never an option.
We wanted to treat the elements about mutants and mutation and powers as just being a part of this drama. In that sense, it's quite an unconventional superhero movie, I think.
It is kind of a thinking person's action film in the sense that, you know, I think you could take
the action sequences out of the film, and you could watch it as a drama and still be very intrigued as to what's going on around you. But the plus side is you get these very cool sequences thrown in there as well.
So your mutation is what? You're super smart?
I'll say. Hank here graduated Harvard at the age of 15.
I wish that's all it was.
You're among friends now, Hank. You can show off.
I'm sorry.
You're amazing.
Full credit to Matthew. I think he has made what we were all hoping for, which is an entertaining ride with a lot of interesting social comments within that and interesting philosophies. It's 2 hours, 12 minutes, and I didn't feel that time pass. I was totally engaged throughout the film. So, yeah, very happy, very lucky, very grateful.
Well, I've never really felt the X-Men movies are classic popcorn movies in the American term, because they've always had a much higher-minded sort of goal in a way, or ambitions to be having something to say on themes, which I think are fantastic, and particularly for teenagers.
I've always been very fond of, resist the word franchise, the continuing story of X-Men, because it's not just a spectacular movie of special effects in a fantasy world. That's all at the service of a rather human story of how does society treat its minorities, and what is it like to be in a minority when society is at odds with you.
We came along in First Class, and suddenly there was an X-Men movie without Wolverine, and it was a case of how's this going to work? And Michael and I were a bit like, we better make it work. And of course, our relationship kind of formed a new spine to that particular story. So, but to have him, to have that guy, that backbone of the X-Men until First Class come into your movie was really exciting. I mean, you know, he is like the flame of X-Men, you know, and he turned the heat up, to continue that metaphor.
Professor?
You're gonna find this hard to believe.
I was sent here for you.
From the future?
50 years from now.
Could you give me that one more time, please?
Stay with me.
It's a very different Professor Xavier than I've ever known before. So this is really his crisis, where he could really go off the rails. In fact, he's very much off the rails at the beginning of this movie. So it's his, what Wolverine's been called on to do, and in the relationship between him and all the other characters, what I like about it is he's not just being sent in there to slice and dice and take people's heads off and, you know, just force things into happening, but he's having to be somewhat of a politician or a mentor or a motivator, which I wouldn't have said were his natural skills.
So I wake up in my younger body, and then what?
Find me. Convince me of all of this. It's great to take the two of us.
And where do I find you?
A different path. A darker path.
At one point, Fassbender as Magneto in the familiar helmet is, with gestures that I can recognize, is destroying his environment, a stadium that he seems to be in the middle of. And then they photograph him from behind, and it could be me. And so, in a sense, he and I are genuinely sharing the part, and I think perhaps when these effects happen, people aren't going to say, oh, that's Fassbender, oh, that's McKellen. No, it's not, it's Magneto.
You know, I took over from Patrick in First Class, and I thought that was it. I thought they were gone. Having a scene with him in this one, bringing him back, actually feels like the baton gets passed over a little bit. And that felt quite ceremonial, strangely. And because it was quite a ceremonial setting. We were in a monastery, and it was very low lights, and it felt all a little bit like I was being, even though I've played Charles before, it was like I was being initiated, do you know what I mean, by some weird mutant stroke actor sect.
We need you to hope again.
Honestly, to be able to go and have scenes with Jennifer Lawrence or Michael Fassbender or McAvoy or Nicole, all these great actors, and then obviously in the future, all the other actors playing the same characters, it was pretty amazing. And it's a... You won't be surprised because you know Bryan Singer's movies, and X-Men fans know, and they saw what he did with one, and particularly with two, how he loves intricacies of big casts and big ensembles. He likes to make it. He doesn't serve it to you all on a platter. He likes you to actually work it out a little himself. And if you add to that the mechanics and the rules of a time travel movie, which he's a massive fan of as well. So he's trying to make a definitive time travel movie as well as a definitive kind of superhero movie. So he had a lot at stake, which I think is important for any of us.
To me, X-Men Apocalypse is actually the end, or the climax, I should say, of six films, beginning of X-Men 1, 2, and 3. So it incorporates a lot of homages to those. But, you know, it was important, one, for it to be very different from any other X-Men film, including a villain who is radically different. He's based in ancient times. He makes no distinction between humans and mutants like Magneto. And also, it's kind of the birth of the X-Men. It's the story of how the true X-Men came to be.
We've done time travel, two casts, Sentinels, End of the World, in Days of Future Past, and obviously we want to do more of these films. So what could potentially have more stakes and scale than this movie? And there was really only one character in the history of the X-Men comics that could give us that as a possibility, and that was Apocalypse.
They call themselves a Shear en Sebanur, named after an ancient being they believe to be the world's first.
World's first what?
The world's first mutant. These describe a specific set of powers greater than any man could possess.
An all-powerful mutant.
Exactly. And wherever this being was, he always had four principal followers, disciples, protectors he would imbue with powers.
Like the four horsemen of the apocalypse. You got that one from the Bible.
So one of the things that Bryan and I spent a lot of time working on, and I spent a lot of time in script form, and then Oscar and I spent a lot of time talking about, was not what does he want,
Charles!
But why does he want it? So we came to this place of, you know, a character, a man who had fallen asleep essentially at a time when he thought the world was perfect, and woke up in what one could argue was the sort of most disgusting, awful time in our modern history, which is the 1980s. And that goes for, in a jokey way, the clothing and the hair and the music, and in a serious way in terms of pollution and greed and, a lot of other things that were going on in the 80s that you could relate to this character wanting to wipe clean from the face of the earth.
The world needs the X-Men.
I mean, I've been doing this since The Usual Suspects, directing films with ensemble casts. And yes, there's always a few central characters that you adopt as the center of your movie or the centers of your movie. And then you have to make sure that the peripheral characters or the supporting characters have a presence and they have arcs as characters. And then you get the full feeling of a real experience. And that, to me, with all the action and, you know, and there's plenty and scope of a movie like this, it's rooted in its story and characters. And because I've had such a multi-decade experience with X-Men, a lot of it comes second nature to me.
If I'm going to teach your kids something, I'm going to teach them how to fight.
This movie actually patterns a lot after X-Men 1 and 2. There's an origin beat, a character discovering his power. We see a villain born in history. We enter the mansion through a new character's eyes. We have a cage fight. there's a few similarities. Also, the other task that's a real interesting one is once they start battling each other, who do you pit against who? If it's the wrong combination, one would win like that, so you have to kind of pit them evenly against each other, and that's always a bit like a dance.
Not all of us can control our powers.
Then don't.
I think because of the level of actors that we get now and the seriousness of purpose with which we approach these films, there is a different respect than they might have gotten.
Well, you've been busy.
We had a little help.
It should never feel like we're trying to top ourselves and get bigger, but if you look at them, they do grow in size and proportion and scope. This one particularly, lots of destruction, Apocalypse as a character is so powerful. So they do escalate, and I am conscious of it. You know, I used to compete with other films, now I'm competing with myself. But at the same time, I don't want the audience to feel that. I want the audience to feel this is a natural progression. This is the right movement in a story, in a group of films. And I also am very conscious, particularly with this film, of newcomers to the universe. And I've met with a few people who've never seen an X-Men film. This was their first one, and it has excited them to go back and kind of revisit the other ones. And that was really important to me.